So this week we will be talking about fitting observed frequencies to expected probabilities. So basically we will be dealing with analyzing categorical data. So let me write the topic so that you can maybe follow it better. So the name for this week's topic is fitting expected probabilities to frequency data. Or you can also think about it vice versa. So we have frequency data at our hand and we will be testing whether they have a good fit to some expected probabilities, some theoretical probabilities. Some other way of calling this is a goodness of fit test, actually. This is a much more frequently used name, actually, goodness of fit test. And what we will be doing using technically is we will be actually using chi-squared test for this. So it's called chi-square test. So just let me okay, basically this topic is a continuation from last week. So last week we have seen how to analyze proportion data. In that case, again, we had a categorical variable, but it had only two possible outcomes, two possible categories. In this week, we will be dealing with when there are more than two possible categories. So basically a more general case for analyzing one dimensional, one variable with one categorical variable. Okay, for just illustrating what kind of data we will be using, you can download from OptiClass data that we will be using for our first example. And so let us work on some illustrations so that we see what kind of variables, what kind of data we will have. And based on that variable, we will be applying our functions. For this week, the data is in the format of R data. So, and the name of the data is, okay, I need to change my working directory to my documents. So also you could do the same thing with this function, set WD function. And the name of the data file is day of birth. Okay, just let me check if, okay, thank you, Etka, it should be days of birth. So you can see how the data looks like. So remember that instead of when we have CSV file, we are using read.csv function. But if we have an R data file, if we have a data file in that format, we will use this load function. And in that case, it loads some objects to our environment. And here you can see in our global environment an object called days of birth. And you can see that it has 350 observations for a single variable. And if we are a little bit more curious how the data looks like, we can check its first few lines. So you can see that it's a categorical data. So what we see is a single column and it has week names of the week, the names of the weekdays. So the data is for 350 newborn babies. Their birthdays are recorded. It looks very obvious. So the question is whether there is some pattern, so that on some days of week births are more frequent and in some other days of week the births are less frequent. Well, we don't expect such a thing, right? But let us check that question based on this data. And also, before proceeding, let me check the class of the object. So it's always a good practice to see how it looks like. So it's a data frame. So although it's a single column object, it's a data frame, and when we need to use that data, we need to specify or specifically write the column we will be using, even if it's only a single column present like this. And you can see that it's of type factor. So our data frame has a single column and it's a factor type of column, a factor type of object. Okay. Now whenever we are dealing with frequency data, so is this error when you are trying to load, right? Okay, I think Etika has a solution to that problem, and I will just proceed. Now, we may have, let me call this representation of the data. Well, maybe you may think that I'm spending too much time of representation of data, so how the data can be organized or represented, but I think most of the confusion regarding how to analyze data roots from this part. So it's really important that you first get a good grasp of the data. So when we are dealing with a categorical variable, so this, it can be given into alternative ways. So the maybe you can call it the row data, or the not row like lines, but row like row material. So it can be given like this, so that for each observation we can see to which category that observation belongs. So each observation is listed, but most of the time we don't need that detailed record of the data. Instead, because you know we cannot make operations on Tuesday plus Sunday, etc., so we need some numbers, and that numbers actually are summarizing our data. So instead of using this, actually we need to transform this. Furthermore, when we are doing analysis, so one way you may encounter data is like this. Another possible way of encountering the data is, the second possible form is, you can think of this as summarized. So counts of observations in each category. So you may get the data in one of these two possible forms. If you have the data in the first form, you need to convert it to the second form to be able to do an analysis. But if you have the data given like this, then you don't need to do anything. You can just go ahead and make your analysis. Honestly, I don't remember if we have already shown you the function called table. But what this table function does is, for a data given in this row format, for a categorical data, it will convert it to this second representation type. So in this case, it will count how many babies are born on Wednesday, how many of them are born on Tuesday, etc. So if you give our categorical column to this table function, so you can see a summary of our data. So these two are basically representing the same thing. So the second form is obviously it has lost some information because so in this first one we know exactly which observation belongs to which category, but most of time we don't need that information. It is enough for us if we know that how many of the babies are born on which day of the week. So it's important to remember that we can use this function to convert categorical data in this format, in this, let me call it row format, to the summarized or tableized format. And of course, if we need to use this data further, we need to save it in another object. For example, we can call it, let's say, birthdays frequencies. I don't know if it is a very good naming, but you can name it better. Okay, and then let me check what the class of this new resulting object is. Okay, it says that it's of class table, but a table class is nothing different. Well, it depends on its dimensions, but a single dimensional table works just like a vector. So you can think of this as a named vector. So the category names are names of the elements, and these numbers are the values within vector. So for example, we can subset or retrieve the values just like we are subsetting vectors. For example, if you want to get the first element from this frequencies, you can see that this way we can get 56 for Friday. Okay. So for the part of analysis, so before starting the actual first example, so actually we already have started a little bit from the first example, but I want to show you, or I want to introduce you all the functions that we actually, there are only three functions that we will be using today. So the first one is this table function. And the other two are they are related to the chi-square test. So one of them is chi-square test and the other one is p chi-square. So they actually more or less serve the same purpose. So for both of them will be used for making a goodness of fit test. So the first one is a easier to use one. So so basically when we are making a goodness of fit test, we have two elements to compare. One of them is our data. So in this case, our data is this. For the first example, related to the first example, our data is this. These are the observed values. And we need furthermore some vector of expected probabilities. So in this case, and this vector of expected probabilities, we will determine it, and it will be determined according to null hypothesis we have. For example, for the first example, Most convenient null hypothesis could be that on each day of the week we expect same number of children to be born, right? So in that case, we will have expected probabilities of 1 over 7 for each of the categories, right? So in some other examples, our expected or our null hypothesis, our expected probabilities can be different, and it will be obvious from the question. So there is no single way of determining the expected probabilities in the case of goodness of fit test. It will always depend on the question. But basically, we will have two objects. One of them is our observed frequencies. The other one is the expected probabilities. So in the case of chi-square test, so if some certain criteria is hold, criteria are holding, then we may simply use chi-square test, and we can just give as the first argument, let me again write some pseudo object names. For example, let me call this. So we don't have such an object right now, but just to illustrate how this syntax of the function works. So as the first argument, we can write a vector which holds the number of observations for each category, and as the second argument, we will be giving expected probabilities. And we will see that we will not be always able to use this function, and we will see it shortly when this the case is. In whenever we cannot use this one, we can use this p chi-square function, and the logic behind it is this. So just like the case of binomial distribution and binomial test, so each hypothesis test is based on a theoretical probability distribution, right? So in R, we have functions that calculate probabilities based on theoretical probability distributions, and also there are some wrapper functions that do hypothesis tests based on those probability distributions. So in the case of goodness of fit tests, our underlying distribution, the theoretical distribution, is chi-square distribution. So under chi-square test underlies a chi-square distribution. And remember that whenever we have a theoretical distribution, in R we have this family of functions, for example R chi-square. This will generate us random numbers from chi-square distribution, but we won't need it right now. Actually, we will not need it throughout this semester. Remember that similar to, okay, maybe it's better to write this. So remember this p-norm function, it will calculate us cumulative probability from the normal distribution. Similarly, we had p-post that calculates some cumulative probability for given values from the Poisson distribution, and similarly we have this p chi-square read it like this, p chi-square function, which gives us probability. I'm trying to tell you about this difference, but I think it will be more clear in the examples. So actually I just have I tried to explain the chi-square test. Now this p chi-square function gives you the cumulative probability that corresponds to a given chi-square value, and chi-square value is the test statistic. Okay, let me write like this. So in goodness of fit tests, so in each kind of hypothesis test, we have a test statistic that is calculated. And in this case, our test statistic is called chi-square, and it's like an italic X, italic capital X, and square of it. And it's calculation, or it what it represents is for each category it is the sum of each of the differences of expected and observed frequencies. So you, basically you I think you already know this from the theoretical lecturers. So for each of the categories we subtract from the expected values on that category the observed counts on that category, and we get the square of that difference, and then sum all of these square differences. And okay, it's now correct. So first we will divide each of these square differences to the corresponding expected count, and then those values will be summed up for all of the categories. Now this, if we calculate this statistic, this test statistic, it will be, so if the these expected and observed values are really random, they are from the same theoretical distribution, and the only thing that causes a deviation is just random chance. If this is the case, then this test statistic called chi-square will be distributed according to chi-square distribution. So this chi-square name stands both for the test statistic and also for the distribution from which that test statistic comes from. So it's both a name for the test statistic and a name for a theoretical distribution. Okay. So for some, basically there are two possible ways in R for making a Gutlisov fit test. So these both functions are based on chi-square distribution. The first one is a wrapper that automatically calculates, makes, conducts a hypothesis test. The second one is a probability calculation function, but we can use it so that we can calculate a p-value. So the first argument for this function is the test statistic. So basically, if we need to use this second function, p chi-square function, we need to calculate this chi-square statistic by ourselves manually. And moreover, we need to specify degrees of freedom again manually. And then we need to also specify if we are interested in lower tail or the let's say higher tail. And as we are dealing in differences, and we will be rejecting the null hypothesis if the difference is high, the corresponding p-value will always, in the case of chi-square test, the corresponding p-value will be always on the higher tail, on the right tail. So if we are making a hypothesis test with chi-square, so in contrary to other hypothesis tests, we don't need to consider whether it's a one-sided or two-sided. It's always a one-sided test, and it's always, the alternative is always greater. Okay. So basically, these are two different functions, two alternative functions for doing the same thing. So in the first function gets only the observed frequencies and expected probabilities, and does the other things automatically by itself. But we will see in the second example that this has some limitations. Hence, we will be in the case when this is not usable. In the case when this is not flexible enough. And this case is actually whenever we need to define the degrees of freedom manually by ourselves. In that case, we can use this p chi-square function to compute the p-value by using the properties of the chi-square distribution. Okay. Okay, I think that much introduction is enough. Sorry for it be taking so long. So what you need to know is basically this chi-square test statistic is, so we have categories, and for each category we have observed values, and we can also retrieve somewhere else whether it's given in the question, or we may by using our logic retrieve that expected probabilities. So for each category, the difference between expected and observed values will be squared and divided to the number of expected observations. And if we sum these values for all of the categories, we will get the chi-square test statistic. And it is distributed, if there is no other effect than random chance, it will be distributed according to a distribution which is again called chi-square distribution. And then, depending on our case, we may use either one of these two functions to get a p-value that specifies or that signifies whether our observed values are significantly different than some given expected probabilities, some expected ratios or not. Okay. So let us start with the first example as a concrete example and how we will be actually using this function. So I just tried to get you familiar with the objects that we will be using. So basically we will have data and we need to define expected or theoretical probabilities, and then we will give them as input in such a way, and we will get our p-values. So in the first example, we have weekday of birth data from 350 babies and our newborns, and the question is there a preference for some days of the week for births? How can we test that? So the So this is the first example. It's better maybe so that we can read it together. So this is what I already have told you. And so we have already again calculated the frequency of birth on each weekday. So they were basically around 70. I think you should be now seeing a single lab manual, right? Okay. Sorry for the lag. Maybe there can be 5 seconds lag, but we will not going back and forth between manual and RStudio very frequently. It will be just maybe occurring a few more times. So the first example wants us to visualize the distribution for births on weekdays. So this is actually not necessary to conduct a hypothesis test, but just to get a visual feeling how the data looks like. It's good that before doing an actual statistical analysis, we can also, before start, we can visualize the data. And then it says under the proportional model. Proportional means that, so each, well, proportional doesn't actually always need to be equally probable. So for example, instead of dealing with weekdays, if we were dealing with, let's say, months of birth, in that case, a proportional model would be not 1 over 12 for each of the months, but 13 over 365, 31 over 365, 28 over 365, etc. So in that case, the expected probabilities will be proportional to the length of the months. So this is just similar to the let's say number of, if we are, if we were dealing like the last week's example, number of genes on each of the chromosomes, in that case again our null model could be a proportional model, so number of expected number of genes on each chromosome could be proportional to the expected size of the chromosomes in terms of base pairs, for example. So in the case of, in our case, in this case, a proportional model is same as a equal probability model, because well, each in a given year you may assume that each day of the week has the same number of occurrences. So if you divide 365 to 7, they will be almost equal. Maybe one or two of the days will be one less in so most of them will be coming in 52, and some of them can be 51 or 53, etc. So basically in this case we may think of our null model as, or expected probabilities as 1/7 for each of them. So here our calculation will be actually that simple, 1/7, but we need to specify or give it to R like this. So we need to write a vector that repeats 1/7 seven times. And then the last part of this example asks us to do a actual hypothesis test. So whenever we will be making a hypothesis test, we should start with specifying our null and alternative hypothesis. So we will be testing some hypothesis, but beforehand we need to specify and we need to state what our hypotheses are, and then conduct tests, so make the calculation, it says. And then we need to make it, and we need to write our decision based on the p-values. So just writing the p-value is not enough. We need to specify whether we reject the null hypothesis or we fail to reject the null hypothesis. And then furthermore, we need to also state what this rejection or failure to rejection of null hypothesis means. So statistically and also biologically. So a biological conclusion could be, well, in this case actually I don't think that we can make a biological conclusion, but it can be a sociological conclusion. Maybe people prefer to do it in weekdays. Maybe some doctors don't want to do operations on weekends, etc. It can be such a conclusion, for example. Okay, let us start with the visualization part. Again, it will take some time for me to switch the screens. Okay, what kind of data, what kind of visualization can do you think we can use to show this data? So remember, this is how our data is looking like. So this is the data we will be dealing with. So basically it's a discrete data, and we will be visualizing it with a bar graph, right? Bar plot. Yes, exactly. Now, actually the first part, let me, for sake of completeness, let me repeat this part again. So we have already tabulated, and somehow we have counted the number of births in each day of week. So let me just rewrite this here. And then remember this simple function, and when we give this object named vector, so you can see that it will look like this. If we zoom it, you can see all the names of the elements. So you can see that it is not in a given order. Well, actually, what you can see is it's in alphabetical order. But this order is not determined when we are drawing the bar plot. Instead, that order is already determined when this table function works. And if we want to understand how this order is determined, we can check it from just beginning. So check how the order of days are determined. So just starting with the row data, so days of birth data, we can check. So remember that it was already a factor type of data, right? So it's a data frame and it's single column and its name was day. So you can remember that when we check the class of it, it was of class factor, and we can check levels of factors. And if it is not given in a different manually, if it is not changed manually, levels of a factor is ordered in alphabetical order, so it is not the order in which the category names are appearing. So here you can see that the first observation is Wednesday, second one is Tuesday, etc. But it is not this order that determines the order of levels. Instead, it's the alphabetical order. So basically, we can note here that alphabetical order of levels. And remember that levels are actually the possible categories a categorical variable can have. Now, instead of using this order, if you want to change this order, like let's say the actual order of days within a week, if you want to do it like this, the simplest thing we can do is we can change the original data such that its levels will be redefined. So basically, we will use its same levels. So we will use the same levels, but we can change its order by using this function factor. Remember that we have already used in the first few in the first 2 weeks, first or the second week. I'm not very sure yet, but. So we will get this values, but we will specify the levels again, and these levels will be given within a vector. Now, important thing is that the level names should be the same as the names within data. So for example, I will just redefine the levels, but if I define some levels which are not within the data, those levels will not take any effect. And if I skip some values which are present in the data, but for those there are no levels, in that case, those values will be converted to not available NA values. So basically, you can change the order of levels however you like. For example, you can write it like this. Or it's better to copy and paste in order to avoid any typing mistakes. Now, what I mean is if you just write this tree and execute it, I mean, in this case, actually, it will not take any effect because it will only write it to the output. So let me try how it will look like. So basically what it does is it takes our original data And using that original data, it will create another factor. But in this case, that factor has only three levels. So remember that in a factor type of data, each of the possible values should be listed within levels. Hence, the other values which are not listed within the levels are given as NA values. So hence, we need to avoid these NAs, and we need to avoid them. We need to give all of these. We need to mention all of these values once as a level. And obviously it's case sensitive. So for example, writing it like this will also, this would also cause us a problem. Sorry. So basically each of the names should be written as they are within data. So what this produces, what it does only is, it has changed the order of the levels. You can see that now they are in the order of their coming within a week. But the data is not changed. So the first one was Wednesday, it's still Wednesday, and second one was Tuesday, second birth was on Tuesday, third birth was on Sunday. And okay, you can check if you like. And the original data didn't change, only the levels are changed. And if you want to save this data with this new order of levels, we need to assign it to another object. Let me call it, okay, days of birth 2. So only purpose of creating this second one is to have a nice looking graph. And then we can have an object called, let's say, birthdays freak 2, which is the tabulated or the counted form of this data, our raw data, let's say. And now we can draw bar plot of this birthdays freak 2. Well, you can see that, well, if you want to see the names in full, you can change this window size, and you can see all the names of the categories. And if you like, you could also color it and give names to the axes. Let's call X day and Y lab. Let me call the Y as number of births. And also we could specify a main text like a header for the plot, and we can call it distribution of births on weekdays. So if we execute this, so we can have a more nice looking graph that shows the distribution of our data. So it depends on how you interpret it. Someone can say that, okay, there are some differences, but those differences can be very high or not very high. So 52 is the, if all of the weekdays have equal probabilities, then they expect, okay, it should be around 50, right? Because we have 350 births and 7 weekdays, so We can draw, actually we can do it also. Just let me add this line, AB line, and it should be horizontal and at 50. Right? Okay. So now yes, checks names could also be a option to write these namings properly. But let us turn back to the data. So you can see some of the days have less births than expected, some of them are more than expected. But is this deviances statistically significant so that we can say that there is an effect, or can we see such deviations by just chance only? So for example, you can see that on Sundays and on Mondays there are very few births compared to the other ones. Well, not very few, but the deviations are the most on these days. Maybe you can think of them like many births are planned beforehand using C-section, etc. And doctors don't want to plan many of them on Sundays and Mondays. So Thursdays are also and Saturdays are also lower than the expected or the average, but that difference is not that much. Hence, and the Sundays and Mondays, the missing births are scheduled maybe on Tuesdays and Wednesdays more often. So this could be an explanation, possible explanation, if we can say that this difference is significant. So first we need to determine whether this differences from the expected average value is significant or not, right? So for doing this, we need to conduct the hypothesis test. And I think it's very clear what we are after. All right. Now, as the third part of the question, you can also follow it from the manual. I don't want to switch the screens because it takes some time. So under the proportional model, calculate the expected probabilities. So we will simply assume that each day of week has had the same number of occurrences within that year. And because of that, let me so basically this will be our expected probability vector in this case, for the case of the first example. So you can just count it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So this is one way of defining it. And as Hamid says, another way of doing this is using this ref function. I think we already seen how to do it. So you can see this ref function has this argument, the value that we will be repeating. And then if you write it like this, it will repeat this thing 7 times. Well, if you like, you can also check it. Well, actually I want to also check this its help page, because I also don't remember how could we use this ref function in other cases. So in the simplest case, it's okay to use it like this. So we just want to repeat a single number 7 times. But this function can also serve more complicated cases. So we could use some multiple values to be repeated. So instead of a given value, we could give a vector of values. And then we can let it repeat it. Okay, as times is one of the arguments. So length out is okay. Actually, I think this is again the well. In the case of we are repeating a single value, these two will be doing the same thing for us. Well, if you can see there is this each argument. So let's say if we had if we liked to repeat some values like 1 over 2 and 1 over 3, if we like to repeat those multiple times, what we could write is, well, let's say if we want to write 3, it would repeat these two 3 times. So you can see it here, 1 over 2, 1 over 3, 1 over 2, 1 over 3, etc. Instead, we could have written each 3 times. So this time the first one will be repeated 3 times, then second one will be repeated 3 times. Or we could write length out, let's say 7. This will produce us a vector of total length 7. So, okay, it's not true. Because it's not typed correctly. Okay, it goes up to 7 times, the same thing. Or if you don't write any name of the arguments, it's the same as this. So basically repeat this 7 times. So I didn't like to give this argument without a name, hence I just tried to get what these possible second arguments might be. So it's always useful to check this help page of the functions. So this way, okay, let us return to our original question. This way we could give our expected probabilities. So it's never a nice thing to copy and paste that many things, because it's really error prone. So you can easily add a couple of them in excess, or a couple of them could be missing, etc. So let me call this a primitive way of doing this, and let's say our way of doing. Now let us store this as expected probes. So as you can see, in this first case, we have defined the expected probabilities just by using our logic. And now what is left is to conduct the hypothesis test. So for doing this, state null and alternative hypothesis. So null hypothesis is that, well, maybe it's still confusing for some of you, but as a rule of thumb, a null hypothesis is a hypothesis of no effect or no difference. So here in this case, the observed frequencies are in good fit to expected probabilities. Or you can express this in some other ways if you like. So you can say that observed frequencies are according to observed frequencies are distributed according to expected probabilities, you can say. Or even you may say that they are the same, because the null hypothesis is referring to some ideal case. So even if they are not really the same, in the case of null hypothesis, you can say that observed frequencies and expected frequencies are the same. So this may again be acceptable, because as I said, null hypothesis it refers to some ideal case. And alternative hypothesis is that, well, they are not, because the alternative hypothesis should always be complementary to the null hypothesis, meaning that there should be no other way, no other third option. So either So it should be either the null hypothesis or the alternative hypothesis. So alternative hypothesis should be everything as the null hypothesis. So they are not in good fit, or they are not the same, you can say. So alternatively, you could write observed frequencies and expected frequencies are the same, and here you can say that observed frequencies and expected frequencies are not the same. So maybe something can have drawn your attention that sometimes I'm talking about expected probabilities, sometimes I'm talking about expected frequencies, but as we know the total number of observations, expected frequencies are just the total number of observations times expected probabilities, right? So just write it, let me write it within parentheses. So when we are using the word frequency, what we mean is the count numbers. And when we are talking about probabilities, what we are talking about is you can think of them as ratios. So basically numbers between 0 and 1. Expected probability times number of observations. So you can think of it like this. If let's say this is the probability of a bird being on Monday, and if we are observing total 350 birds, we expect that many of them to be on Monday. So it's basically around 50. Actually, if I had written the full not truncated value, it will be exactly 50. Well, as there is this simple relation between them, we can use any if we know one of them, and this will be always known to us. Hence, we can use one of them as we like in principle. But for using the when it comes to using the functions, so this first chi-square test function needs you to give the probability values, so the values between 0 and 1. In this case, however, in the second function, when we need to calculate the test statistic, here you can see that in the case of test statistic, both the observed and expected should be the frequency values, the count values. Hence, when we are using this chi-square test function, we will be needing the expected probabilities, and in the other case, we will be using the expected frequencies, and we will be again seeing it shortly. So basically, these are our. But in the case of hypothesis, you is stating the hypothesis, you can use either expected frequencies or expected probabilities, it doesn't matter. Okay, now let us use this chi-square test now. So when I mean conducting the test, I mean to making the actual calculation. So this is the chi-square test. And our first we need to write our observed values, and observed values are the this count values, remember. So you can use any of them. So remember that we have two different orders, but as all of them are expected to have this, so both of them have the same expected probabilities, you can use any one of them. So you can just select one of them. And then the second argument is, okay, it's P. And here we need to give the expected probes that we have defined just a second ago. Okay, now if we execute this simple code, it will give us again a simple output. So it gives the name of the data, name of our object. So here you can see the chi-squared value. So if you like, we could also calculate this by ourselves and see that they match the same thing. And degrees of freedom is here number of categories minus one. And here we can see the p-value. So the degrees of freedom is, okay, let me first make a conclusion based on this output, and then I will come to discuss how this degrees of freedom is determined and when we need to specify it manually, when we can use just the automatical version of it. Okay, now if you use this chi-square test function, you will get this output, and we don't need to specify the alternative hypothesis, because in the case of chi-square test, alternative hypothesis is always the same. So basically we can give this to observed and expected vectors, and you will get the corresponding p-value. And as we already get the p-value, this test statistic, calculated test statistic, is really not very important to us. So we will be making our decision and then conclusion based on this p-value. So the hypothesis test in R doesn't give us a decision based on this. So because we don't give it a alpha value, so we don't specify our significance threshold, but we based on our own interpretation, for example, we can, if it is not said something else within the question, we can use alpha .05. So most, it's customary to use this 0.05 as a significant threshold. So any p-value below this value is considered significant, statistically significant, and any p-value greater than this one is considered not significant. But it can be changed. So if you specify, if you report alongside with your p-value your designated alpha value, it is acceptable. But it will be either given in the question. If it is not given you in the questions, you can safely assume or safely use alpha 0.05. So now our decision will be, here the p-value is less than alpha, right? So this means that we will reject the null hypothesis. So decision is as p is less than alpha, reject the null hypothesis. And then we will have two conclusions. By statistical conclusion, I mean, well, if you like, you could also express this somewhat differently, but if you reject the null hypothesis, so it's good that you recite what you are actually rejecting. So a statistical conclusion is that here observed frequencies are not in good fit to expected ones. So you can think of this as a statistical conclusion. Basically, this is the reciting or rephrasing the null hypothesis here, so, or specifying what you have rejected. So here the decision is to reject, and here you write what you are rejecting. And then a biological conclusion, well, the simplest obvious will be again just rephrasing the what is in your question. So this will be asked from you always, because otherwise people just report some p-value and they may just forget the relation of that p-value with the question, and so this should be not they should be connected. So this p-value is an answer to the question we have beforehand, and we should write the connection explicitly so that we reason or we make a good interpretation of the conducted test. Otherwise, it's not really a test. It's just some random calculations. And the biological conclusion, again, is simplest or the most trivial form could be that birds are not equally distributed throughout the week. You can just write this if you like. So even this doesn't give us a real explanation. It means that you understand what you have done and what this means. Well, in order to make a more explanatory conclusion, well, it's just speculations, but if you like, you can also furthermore speculate, like doctors C-sections are getting more frequent and scheduled births are less likely to be on Sundays and Mondays. Well, this could be your speculation. If you this is optional, but it is really important that you, after getting this p-value, after calculating this p-value, it is really important that you clearly state your decision and also the statistical conclusion, so what you are rejecting or not rejecting, and then what does this mean for our question. So it doesn't need to be something very informative, but it need to be addressed the real question in the example, in the question, okay. So they should be connected somehow, okay. Well, this is at last the end of the first example, but I think I very detailed explanation. I hope it's very clear for all of you. So if you have any questions, I can wait just for a few seconds. Otherwise, I will continue with the second example. So the next and the third example is a very, very short example. So the second one maybe can take half an hour. I think it will be not very effective to give a break, hence let me continue, please. So I don't see any questions on the chat box, so I will continue. So the second example will have many things different from the first example. Well, actually, in the first example, we didn't check some of the things that we actually needed to check. Well, what things can be different? Let me list them. In goodness of fit tests, three things can be different from question to question. Actually, maybe four. Well, it depends on how you again interpret it. One is the type of given data, whether it is in raw form or it is already in frequency form. And then the second one is how we determine the theoretical, let's say, or expected probabilities. So this can be dependent on data or independent. Dependent or independent from the data. So in our example before, it was independent of the data, right? So without getting any information from the data, just beforehand we used our logic to say that the null hypothesis or the expected probabilities should be that they all should be equal. Hence, we didn't use any information from the data. So this will being the expected probabilities dependent or independent from the data, this will change the degrees of freedom. And okay, let me first try to explain this, and then I will move on to the third part. So the dependent independent thing is that, so when we don't estimate any parameter for the theoretical or for the expected probabilities from the data, in that case we will have n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So we had 7 categories and 7 minus 1, we had 6 degrees of freedom. But in the case of, so in the next example, in this case, we will see that actually we may need some information from the data so that we can calculate some expected probabilities. So for being able to calculating theoretical probabilities or theoretical frequencies, we may need to estimate some parameter from the data. In that case, we will lose degrees of freedom according to how many parameters you will be estimating from data, and most of the time it will be only a single parameter from the data. So in that case, we will lose another degrees of freedom. So in that case, it will be n minus 2 degrees of freedom. Well, this is important because when we want to use this chi-square test function, so as we have done in the previous example, I will assume that we don't use any information from the data. So I will, in the case of chi-square test, I will assume that we don't use any information from data. Hence, it will, without asking us anything, it will just use degrees of freedom 6. But this the null distribution or the theoretical distribution behind this test is a family of chi-square distributions, and each specific distribution is specified by the degrees of freedom. So using the false degrees of freedom will give us a false p-value. Hence, we need to carefully inspect the degrees of freedom, the used degrees of freedom when using this test. So in the first case, as our expected probabilities were retrieved independent of the data, we could use this chi-square test function. But in the next example, we will use a parameter estimation from the data, and in that case, we will be not able to using this chi-square test because there is no way to give it as an input value to this function. Hence, we will use the second alternative of doing the chi-square test. Now, another important thing to consider that we didn't done is, The assumption of chi-square test is that each category has at least 5 expected counts or expected frequencies. So in the previous case, each of them was greater than 30, hence we didn't we were not concerned about it, but in general we need to check before doing the analysis whether each of the be careful, this should be not the number of observed frequencies but the number of expected frequencies. Hence we need to alongside with the expected probabilities, we also need to calculate the expected frequencies always, so according to this formula, and check that whether it's all of the whether all of the categories have at least 5 expected frequencies. If this is not the case, then we need to merge or we need to combine the categories that are that have less than 5 expected frequencies, and in that case we will be making a less than optimal use of the data, but it is needed for the sake of accuracy. Okay, so the differences between the first and second example are in we can summarize them in these three cases, in these three headings, let's say. Okay, then let me show you the second. Let me show you the second example on the manual. Again, let us read it together so that we will be on the same page. So this is about how the fungi are distributed on the field. So people, researchers want to know whether fungi are distributed again equally or randomly on a field, or they have some preferences for some spots. So for doing this, they have divided a area into 100 equal pieces, 10 by 10 grid, and then they have counted how many individuals of fungi in each of these grids are. Now an important thing here is that in this case, in the previous case, our observations were birds, or the observations were the babies. But in this case, the observations are actually not the fungi, but the observations are the each one of these 100 areas, 100 sub areas, or you can think of them. And then for each of these 100 areas, the area is categorized as one of the these 5 possible things. An area can be either having no fungi, an area can have a single fungi on it, fungus on it, and or it can have 2 organisms on it, or 3 or 4. So these are the observations. Actually it could have 5, 6, 7, etc., but for this data we have observed only these cases. So 32 of these 100 areas have no fungus on it, and 36 of them have a single fungus on it, etc. So this is our data here. So basically we have 5 categories, and these are the observed numbers that belong to those categories. Okay, now our question is, are these areas distributed randomly as having that many fungi on them? So if you can think of this case, and you can see that it can be modeled using Poisson distribution. So I think you have already seen it in the lecture hours as well, and we already used those Poisson models in the previous weeks for making just basic probability calculations. So now we will use those theoretical probabilities, Poisson probabilities, to calculate the expected probabilities, and so expected probability of seeing a area, a field part with no fungus on it, and again the same probability, again the probability of the same thing for having an area, observing an area with a single fungus only, etc. So for calculating this, we need to estimate the lambda value for the Poisson distribution, right? And as we have no other information regarding the distribution of the fungi, we need to use this observed values in order to estimate a lambda value. So we have these observed values, and then we need to calculate some expected probabilities. But for being able to calculate those expected probabilities, we need to calculate a lambda parameter from the data. And this lambda can be calculated according to again just basic logic. So basically, lambda is an average number of fungi per area, per unit area. And zero of the 100 areas, sorry, 32 of these 100 areas had no fungi on it. And one of them, sorry, 36 of them had a single fungi on it, etc. So this way, we can calculate the total number of fungi on that experiment, right? And if we divide it to the total number of areas, we can get basically the average number of fungus per area. Now, if we get this lambda value, it is very easy to use this dPoS function to get the expected probabilities for each of them. So we can basically calculate it using this function. And then if after we get the expected probabilities, it's again very easy to get the expected frequencies. We will just be multiplying each of them with 100, and 100 is the sum of these values. And then we will check whether any one of, so you can see that here two of the categories have observed frequencies less than 5, right? Here we have 1 and 2. But still we don't know whether the corresponding expected frequencies are less than 5 or not. We don't know that yet. So for checking this, we need to calculate the expected frequencies before knowing this. And if any of them is less than 5, then we need to merge those categories, and then after that we can conduct the test. So the degrees of freedom will be depending on how many categories you will left after merging, and then the chi-squared statistic will be calculated using the observed frequencies and then the expected frequencies that we will be calculating. And then after we have these two values, it's very easy to get the p-value, and when we have the p-value, it's straightforward how to interpret that p-value and how to make a conclusion, right? Well, that's true, but so 20% of categories means one in five categories, right? Well, okay, it's a more accurate expression of our assumptions, but if we have less than 10 categories, then if we have five categories, having a category with less than five frequency will fail our assumption, right? So we have five categories here. If we have one of the categories less than five, in this case, it will be that 20%. So if we have five categories, 20% of the categories is, well, one of them. Okay, let us start with this chi-squared calculation of lambda or okay, we have the observed frequencies already as frequencies, so we don't need to tabulate them because we already have those values. Okay, let us define it in R. So let us call it observed frequencies just in order to not confuse it with previous examples objects. I've given it about this field extension, and from the manual we can just copy these five numbers that corresponds to the number of observations. And then we need expected frequencies and also expected probabilities. So first estimate lambda. So again, using our logic, we could deduce it from the question that we need to calculate the expected probabilities using the Poisson distribution, but within the question it can be also given as a hint. But anyway, we know that we need to compare those observed frequencies with theoretical Poisson frequencies, and for doing this we need to first calculate lambda. And again, it is given in the question how to calculate this lambda value, this average number of fungi per area. Here let me copy it like this, and remember that this x's will not be counted as multiplication sign, hence we need to change all of them to those dots. So this part gives us the total number of fungi, total number of organisms, and here is the total number of fields, total number of areas. So when you calculate it, this is the lambda value. So let me store it in this object called lambda. Okay, then expected probabilities for outcomes. So we had in the data outcomes between 0 and 5, right? So we could, using this DPoise function, we could get the probability values between for the outcomes. Sorry, it should be from 0 to 4. And then lambda is our calculated lambda. So please don't get confused. The first one is arguments name, the second one is objects name, and they are not conflicting because they have different namespaces. But if you like, you could, well, it doesn't matter, you shouldn't be confused about that. Now when you calculate this, because here are the expected probabilities, so let us store this as expected probabilities field. or expected field probabilities, and then expected frequencies. And expected frequencies field, let me call it like this again, should be this times. So we already know that there are 100 areas because it's a 10 by 10 grid. If you like, you can just write 100, or so from data we could also retrieve this and see that these add up to 100. Anyway, okay. Now, if you like, we could also write all these observed and expected values as a data frame. Let me call this field data, and in a data frame we can bring them together for a nicer inspection, but it is not again really necessary, but if you like you can do it. So we can just bring them together in a data frame. So observed frequencies, expected probabilities, and expected frequencies. Okay, because I think I didn't save it yet. Now let me see how it looks like now. Okay, it is not well, if you like you could also round them. But again, as they are not actual values but idealized values, we don't need them to be whole numbers, we don't need them to be integers. Okay, but still, when you want to interpret, you can think of them as integers. So here you can see the observed and expected counts. Yeah, I think this can stay because it's, again, it's an expectation, it's not an actual value. So you can, so the expectation can be a ratio even if we are thinking about something that is only meaningful in wholes. Okay, well, here important thing is that we need to check whether some of them are less than 5. So Kahn's expression of the assumptions is a more accurate way according to our textbook, but some other textbooks don't bother that much about it. Well, it's okay, it's better to stick to the actual assumption written in the textbook. But here, well, according to it, actually we could we could say that this is okay because it is only, it corresponds only to 20% of the categories, so 1 in 5 of the categories. So it says at least, so maximum 20% of them can have less than 5. So we could say that this is okay and we could just let it go according to Kahn's concern, and again according to our textbook we could just leave it as it is here. But just to show you how we would proceed in case we had, let's say if we had two of the categories that are less than 5. Okay, let's say check number of, or check expected frequencies for being less than 5, let's say. So here we have only a single category which is less than 5, so it is okay. Well, if we had two of them less than five, then in that case, what we will do is remember how to use subsetting and how to use subsets of vectors to create other vectors. Just as an exercise, let us merge two categories. So basically, we will be needing merged observed frequencies and merged expected frequencies. Let me call this merged observed frequency. Well, what you could do is just write it by your hand like this, 32, 36, etc. But as you can see, in the case of expected ones, we have, if you want to be exact, it is better to use the values themselves. Retrieving them using subsetting is better than by manual typing. Hence, instead of writing it like this, what we can do is, what we will do is, I will use the original vector. This way, I will get the first three elements. Okay. So basically, I want to create a new vector using this old vector. So remember, using this C function, it's basically we create. It will be creating new vector using the elements as its input. So here, this way, the first three elements will be included in our new vector. And as the new fourth element, I want to get the summation of these two. Okay. So basically, I will again get the original vector's fourth element plus original vector's fifth element. Like this, okay. Now you can see how it looks. Obviously, it's just summed up this one and two, and instead of five categories, now we have four categories. And the same thing can be done on these expected ones, right? Okay, I think I can explain this times 100 later. Well, it's number of total number of observations. It's not the observed category. It's not the observed frequency. It's the total number of observations. It's these two are different, and I think I can explain it later on. Okay. Okay, merged. Let me call it merged expected frequencies. And again, I will use the same logic from the original expected frequency field object. I will get the first three as they are. And then again, from the same object, from this object, from the same object, I will get the fourth element and fifth element. And I will use their summation as a new element. Okay. Now we have the expected probabilities like this. Well, depending on how strict we will be about the assumptions, we could use the merged data or the original data. So I will just go according to textbook, and well, I think in the previous lab manuals we used this merged ones, but it's I think better to use the strict definition of the assumption. Hence, this was just for exercise purposes. So if you had two groups, so let's say if this was again, this was also less than 5, in that case we needed to merge these two groups, two categories, and in that case instead of 5 we would have 4 categories. And then let us calculate degrees of freedom for that case. Freedom for merged case is there are 4 categories left minus 1 goes always and minus 1 for calculation of lambda. So if we would use merged data, we would have the use of freedom equal to, okay, but instead we will use the original data because it is acceptable to have a single category with less than 5 observations. Continue with original, let's say, not merged data. Okay. Now, what we will be doing is we need to calculate degrees of freedom for for this case, and then we need to calculate the chi-square statistic, test statistic. So we need to, or just write degrees of freedom here in this case is, we have 5 categories, minus 1 is, so if we didn't, if we haven't calculated the lambda from the data, you will have 4 degrees of freedom, but 1 goes for lambda, now we have 3 degrees of freedom, okay? And then we need to calculate test statistic. Well, as instead of 4 we need to use 3 degrees of freedom, we cannot use chi-square test. We can't use this function. But we can use p chi-square function, and for that we need to calculate the test statistic, okay, because that function works like this. So this p chi-square function, for using this we need to specify the chi-square value, and then we need to give the degrees of freedom, and then we can get the p-value, okay? So remember what the chi-square was, chi-square test statistic. So for observed, well, as we will square this difference, it is not important which one comes first here. But be careful that here you should use both of them should be frequency values. So otherwise you will be subtracting from this value, and it will be very huge differences, deviations. So both of those values should be expected, both of them should be frequency values. Okay, just go step by step to construct the chi-square set statistic. So when we calculate this part, let us see. So you can see that it's element by element differences. So 32 minus 34.99. Okay, why it's not like this? No, it's fine. Yeah, it's 2.99, right? Okay. So you can see that they are element by element differences. And then we need to square them. So you can see here, these are the squares. And then so remember that when we are within an expression, when we are using multiple vectors, each of the operations will be made element by element. So then we need to divide by the expected yes, come we could do that also, but I think this is well I will also show you how to do that. Well, it's up to you people which one is more convenient, more easy for you. Okay, well, what Kaan says is okay. I will show it shortly. Now here, using the definition of chi-square test statistic, this way we can calculate it. And when we use the sum function, it will sum all the elements. Hence, so this expression will give us a chi-square value, the test statistic. Well, similarly, using this chi-square test function, we could use the observed frequencies, and then as probability we could give expected probabilities. So this would give us okay, why doesn't it sum up to 1? Yeah, that's true, because okay, here is actually something which is not very can you guess why this thing didn't sum up to 1? So let us see here. So here are probabilities for observing 0, observing 1, observing 2, 3 and 4 fungi on a given field, on a given area. But the thing is that although very small, there are also probabilities for observing 5 or 6 or 7, right? Yeah. And then they are missing, although very small, they are not listed in this probability calculation of ours. So instead of writing this probabilities, what we can do to let them sum up to 1 is we can divide all of the values to the sum of them, so that they will okay, I'm not sure if I can really very quickly explain you this trick, but basically, let's say this value sum up to 0.99, let's say, And if you divide each of these elements by 0.99, then their sum will be 1. So when you divide it to 0.99, you will be increasing each of the elements by their respective proportions, and so this is some kind of normalization, but okay, it's not really very important. The thing is that well, this warning, you can ignore this warning. Actually, this warning is because so although according to our textbooks standards, we can assume that without merging it will be okay. According to our, it says it may be incorrect. So according to our, these assumptions are not really well. So this is the reason I was using. In that border cases, it can be up to you whether to merge or not merge those categories, but this is not our main concern right now. The main concern here is that, so here we had 3 degrees of freedom, right? But if we use chi-square test function, what we have here is 4 degrees of freedom. So although it makes the calculation, the chi-square value true, it uses another distribution from the same family, but it is a different distribution. Hence, the calculated p-value is false because we need to get the p-value with 3 degrees of freedom, not 4 degrees of freedom. Okay, but still this calculated chi-squared value is true, and if you like, we can retrieve this chi-squared value. So instead of manually calculating this one, we could here from this test only retrieve the chi-squared value. And I'm not sure how it is named among the results, hence I want to just store it in this object. And from the results, remember that we can select only the result that we are interested in. For example, here the parameter is degrees of freedom. Okay, it should be statistic. So here we could only retrieve the calculated test statistic from this chi-square function. So if you think that doing this is easier, you can retrieve this chi-squared value from this output. But if you like, you can just use the definition, and okay, and they are somehow different because this chi-square test function also makes some correction. But if you like, we can also select correct false. Let me see if this time they will be the same. Okay, the manually calculated and the computer calculated chi-square values are not the same, but they are very similar to each other. I'm not sure right now what causes this difference, this discrepancy. But basically what we are doing is, this is the first alternative of calculating, and second alternative. So you may choose whatever you like, and as this didn't make any difference, let me just erase this correction thing. Okay, now we want to calculate the p-value. And the p-value is calculated from this function. And okay, we need to here Let me call this chi square 1 and let me call this chi square 2. You can use any one of them. But to get the p value, we will use this p chi squared function. First argument is the calculated test statistic. Second argument is degrees of freedom. We have already calculated it as 3. Here is the reasoning for that. And then it should be lower tail equals false, because alternative hypothesis is always greater than. And whenever we have alternative hypothesis as greater, the lower tail should be false. Okay, because I didn't execute this part. So this is the corresponding p value. So it's it specifies that this observed values, observed frequencies of fields with that given number of fungi is not in a good fit with Poisson distribution. So our decision is, again, as we didn't specify anything else, you can just assume alpha equals 0.05 and p value is less than that. So reject null hypothesis. And what was our null hypothesis? Okay, let me complete this and then I will come to your questions. But lower tail false is the thing when we are doing, when we need to specify alternative hypothesis is greater, and in the case of goodness of fit test, alternative hypothesis should be greater. That's why we specified lower tail equals false. And Inge, I'm not sure why what you have typed differently, but you can check your expression again. I think it should be around 10. And then statistical conclusion is that observed fields are not distributed according to Poisson distribution with respect to number of, it's maybe too long, with respect to number of fungi on them. Yes, chi-square distribution is a continuous distribution. Actually, what we are doing is not an exact probability distribution, but it's an approximate. So in the case of binomial, it was giving us exact p-values because it is an exact test, but this chi-square test is an approximate test. So basically we are, as you can understand, the count values are discrete values, but chi-square distribution is a continuous distribution. Basically we are approximating these discrete differences with a continuous distribution. Actually, this is the reason of that assumption being having expected frequencies greater than 5. If the expected frequencies are less, than this approximation becomes a bad approximation. But if almost all of them are greater than 5, then the approximation is a very good approximation. Okay, so well, this conclusion is actually, this contains both a statistical and a biological component, but still you can think of this as a statistical conclusion, as a biological conclusion, what you can think of them, what you can write is that fungi is not distributed as expected. Or as randomly. So, and if you like to make speculations furthermore, what you can say is that maybe although the mean now, although the expected number of fungi in each of the fields are the same, it can be that presence of some organisms, one of the fungi may change the probability of existing of the other ones. For example, they may help each other so that it is, let's say, it's hard for a new organism to live in a new area, but if there are already some organisms on that area, colonization of the new ones can be easier, or it can be the opposite of them. They can be having a high competition, and then in that case, if there is competition, actually what we would expect is that they should be more uniformly distributed. If they are if they have higher variance, so some patches have systematically less than expected fungi, and some of them has systematically higher than expected fungi, then we can expect cooperation in that case. Because so if some of them can live there, many of them will live there, or none of them be living there. So that's again biological speculations you can add to your conclusion if you think that you have nice good ideas. But if you don't have, just it is enough that you address the original biological question so that you can bridge this p-value to the original question, and so that you can interpret explicitly what you understand from the test. Okay, yes, the only difference between using chi-square or chi-square test or p chi-square functions is the difference in degrees of freedom. So if the degrees of freedom is n minus 1, we will use this function as in the first example, this function. Well, this assumes degrees of freedom is equal to n minus 1 always. It assumes this always. Hence, if we need to estimate some parameters from the data, we cannot use this. So yes, the only difference is that the only reason for not using chi-square test is that we had to define the degrees of freedom by ourselves. Okay, so do you have any questions? Otherwise, I will move to the third example, and it's a very easy example, let's say, because it doesn't have that much details as this Poisson. Well, random, okay, yeah. Well, actually not. In this case, randomly means according to Poisson distribution. So randomly means that there is no other effect than random effects. And for the sake of this question, the random model is more suitable for the more suitable random model is the Poisson model. Okay, so I can tell you that. Well, yeah, it's not. So it didn't need to be uniform here. Okay, let us look at the third example together, and this will be our last part for today. Okay, I think you are now seeing all the randomness can be a uniform randomness or Poisson distributed randomness or normal distributed randomness. It can be anything. By randomness, we mean that the only effect that causes is the random noise. Okay? But the model, the null model, or the null, the null model can should be decided based on the case. Well, I understand that in the first model and the second model, in the first of them we assume uniformity, and in the second one, I think now you are seeing the. Well, I want you to show this. I shared my whole screen to show you the example. So, in the first example, we used basically uniform distribution as our random model. In the second example, we used Poisson distribution for our random model. I think later on I may explain why that the case is by contrasting them, but I already took so much time from you, so let me solve the third example, and then after that let me turn back to that, and people may leave if they like after that. Okay. So the last example is, so an example from a Mendelian experiment. So let's say we are interested in a dihybrid cross, meaning that there are two properties, two traits, sorry, two traits of plants. And in the first filial generation, so in the F1 generation, let's say you have these values are the well the what the traits are not important really. So let's say they are inherited according to this expected ratios. But actually, if they are not if there is no other effects, if they are distributed according to let's say simple dominance and simple dominance model. If these traits are working according or inherited according to simple dominance model, that in that case these are the ratios, expected ratios, and these are the observed values from the experiment. Basically, what we want to do is, can we say that they obey Mendelian ratios, or is there something more is there a more complicated inheritance there? So this is the question. Basically, we want to compare whether these observed values are fitting to that expected ratios or not. Okay, let me change back to our studio. First, define the observed frequencies. Let me call them ment observed. And these are the values given in the example. I will just copy and paste them. And then expected probabilities. So this is the ratio, right? But we need to convert them to probability values so that their total, their summation will be 1. So let me call this ratio. Ratio is equal to 9331. And then this Mendelian expected will be the ratio over sum of the ratio. So if you this way you can, well, it's called sometimes normalization. So if you divide all of the numbers to the total of them, it should be, well, mathematically it must be that their sum should be one. So basically whatever their sum is, you divide all of them to that summed number, hence their new sum will be one. Okay, so and these are the ratio is not found. Okay, now we can use this as expected probabilities. Okay, now here do you think that did we by calculating these expected probabilities, do you think that we use somehow or in any way did we use the observed values? So we didn't use them, right? So because we get this expected, the idea for this expected probabilities, we get them from somewhere else, from Mendelian theory. It is not, and nothing is derived from for calculation of this expected probabilities, nothing is derived from the observed data. Hence in this case the degrees of freedom is number of categories minus one, so the default case. So we have four categories and degrees of freedom is 4 minus 1. So this case, in this case we can safely use the chi-square test function, which is the simpler form of doing the goodness of fit test, right? And the first argument should be the observed values and the second one should be theoretical probabilities. Okay, here we can see the result of our test. But before continuing, let me check if any of the categories have less than 5. Because in this case, if one of the categories has less than 5 expected frequencies, it will violate our assumption. Hence, we need to check it. How can we check it? So the expected frequencies are equal to expected probabilities times total number of observations, right? And total number of observations is, we can sum these observations and see this observed, we can sum these observed frequencies and this is the total number of observations. Here you can see that none of the expected frequencies is less than 5, hence this way it's better to check before doing the test, it's better to check for the assumptions, so the assumptions are not violated, hence we can use the chi-square test without merging the categories. And as we will using the standard degrees of freedom, we can use chi-square test function. And now when we conduct the test, what we can observe, so this is the calculated chi-square value, this is degrees of freedom, and here what we can see is that our decision is that we fail to reject the null hypothesis, fail to reject H0. And H0 is that, H0, let's say, was that, or is that, observed frequencies are according to this ratio, and then we can conclude that these two traits can be inherited according to simple Mendelian inheritance. So there is no reason to seek for more complicated ways of inheritance for those traits, because the ratio from the the hybrid cross is in a good fit with the Mendelian expected ratios. Okay, so this was the last of the examples. In the manual you can see three more exercises, and tomorrow I will upload, together with these lab notes, I will upload solutions to those exercises as well. But please, before looking at the solutions, try to solve those exercises yourself. Okay. And also, note from Hamid, it's a handy, simpler way of how I have checked. So basically, we can use chi-square test function even if we don't conduct the actual hypothesis test with it. So this chi-square test function makes many calculations, even if it doesn't show you all of the calculated values as output. So we can check it like this. Let me, instead of letting it write the output on the screen, on the console, I can assign, or I can store the result in an object called result, and then from this result object I can use dollar sign, and here I can retrieve, I can get many things that have already calculated for me. And as Hamid says, this expected will give us the expected frequencies. And if you are curious about what the other things are standing for, you can just press dollar sign and then just select what you want to know, and you can see what they are. Okay. I think it's all for this week's topic. So tomorrow you will get access to lab notes, so the log of these things that we have done here, and also the solutions to the exercises. And I think we can conclude this webinar here. Yes, Kaan, it's true. Well, whenever so you can, if you like, we can any set of numbers to probability values. Let's say I want to get the probability values for such an ratio. What you can write is 147 divided by sum of 147. So you will get these numbers, and if you sum these new numbers, you can see that it will be 1. Okay, so any set of numbers, if you divide all of them to the total of that set, it's a simple way of converting some ratio to, or ratio of numbers to, the probability values with equal ratios again. Okay, then I think I will conclude this session here. Thank you all for listening. I hope it will be useful. And see you later, okay? Bye, take care.